Came out.
That's good.
That's what he said in this. He says it's already alive. It's just preparing to go to
Okay. It did arrive that time.
Okay, thank you very much for your attendance today. We'll go ahead and get started with our budget meeting, but we do have some other items that we need to address. First is consider an application for a special public event excluded from the noise ordinance requested by Greer Dragway from 4 p.m. to 12 o'clock on Saturday, May 15, 2016, Saturday, May 28, 2016, for a drag race at 1792 Dragway Road to Greer. And motion.
So moved.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative, and it passes. Three, to receive information, take desired action in reference to a request from the auditor's office to eliminate a part-time code enforcement position and utilize part of the savings to reclassify a tax list and clerk of grade 45 to an operations office operations supervisor grade 48. Catherine, anything you'd like to add here?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, I had the opportunity to talk with Councilman Walker about this request. At his recommendation, this particular matter does result in a savings to the county. So in lieu of waiting until the May council meeting when this item would normally come up under personnel and finance, this has been added to your agenda today. To go into some detail on this, and I know that there are some staff members here from the auditor's office to assist with their detailed questions, but to give you an overview of the request, there was a part-time position, a code enforcement position that was in the auditor's office. It was held by Steve Finley, and as council knows, Steve Finley unfortunately passed away. His loss has been great to the county, and this was a difficult decision for Sharon to make. She is asking to eliminate that position and take some of those duties and reclassify a tax listing clerk and move that, as you read, to an office operations supervisor. That will result, because of the savings from the code enforcement position and the elimination of the vehicle that was assigned to that position, that even providing a salary increase for this reclassification, it still results in an over $25,000 savings to the auditor's budget. And since you're in the budget process right now, we've, with council's action today, we can incorporate that into the budget as you're going through it. So there is a budget amendment resolution at your place that if you are in agreement with this change, if you would, as you approve this reclassification and elimination of the part-time position, in essence, what you would be doing is approving the budget amendment resolution before you. That would allow us to incorporate that into your budget planning that you're doing now.
All right, do we have a motion?
I move it, please.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative. It passes. Item 4, render first reading to an ordinance granting a right-of-way easement, installing electric and or communication facilities across property owned by Spartanburg County and used by Drachmeyer Services.
Approval first reading.
Second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative. And it passes. 5, render second reading to an ordinance providing for the issuance and sale of not exceeding $13,375,000 revenue refunding bonds, Public Works Project Series 2016, Spartanburg County, South Carolina, for the expenditure of proceeds for the payment of said bond and matters related thereto. We have a motion for second reading.
So moved.
Second. Any other discussion? Again, no extension, no additional monies for the county. All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative, and it passes. 6, render second reading to an ordinance authorizing Spartanburg County to execute documents including a first supplement to lease agreement by between Spartanburg County and Spartanburg County Tourism Public Facilities Corporation consenting to the issuance of refunding certificates of participation in the first supplemental lease agreement in aggregate principal amount not exceeding $13,250,000. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
We have a motion and a second. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, vote affirmative. It passes. Receive information, take desired action in reference to a budget ordinance related to the fiscal affairs of Spartanburg County. Make an appropriation, therefore, levy of taxes for fiscal year beginning July 1st, 2016 and ending June 30, 2017. Ms. O'Neill, Jim Gill. Staff,
we'll
turn it over to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So as we prepare for today's budget work session, I appreciate all of the time and effort that council has put in to prepare for today. The staff has answered a number of your questions in advance of today's work session, and it obviously your questions were born of much research in the budget and particular areas of emphasis that each of you have as chairman of the various committees that you oversee. So again, thank you for your time and effort. I know it's been hours on your part already in preparing for today. What we've prepared for you is an overview both of the general operating budget as well as the capital improvement plan. I'm going to do the overview for the general operating budget as the first item on your agenda, and then we'll come back to Jim Hip here shortly to provide the overview of the capital improvement plan. If it is okay with council, I'd like for this to be as informal as is practical for us to go through all the matter, but I give you an opportunity to ask questions along the way, if that's okay with you, Mr. Chairman. We're certainly, I think behind me, I have a unique disadvantage. I can't see who's behind me, but I'm assuming that the room is filled with experts on a number of these items in the form of our senior staff. So our agreement is I'll answer the easy questions, they're gonna answer the tough ones.
Well, Catherine, I'd like to say that, again, I think you've made it easy for us to gather information, and I want to thank you, council member, for what I know you spent a lot of time with Catherine and the staff discussing the budget. So anyway, thank you and your staff for making it pretty simple, though, even I can understand.
Well, thank you, Mr. Chairman. And my last comment was certainly in jest. One of the things that the budget staff, Cole Alverson and Kelly Newman, do, and Jim and I do, is we meet individually with each department head or elected official to walk through their budget, what they've requested, what their concerns are, what some of their deferred capital or deferred staffing needs are and try to reach that balance with council's goals and what their needs are on the front line, trying to help our citizens to get access to services and to have projects completed in the county that help the public. So let's start at the beginning with the budget recommendation overview. Just as a starting point, as I shared with council, the budget that's being presented to you is balanced to the revenues that we're forecasting with no tax increase. So with that as the start, let's walk through how we did that. The total budget for the county, that this is all funds, is just shy of $190 million. The general fund will be where we'll spend most of our time today in my presentation. That's roughly $92 million, slightly over that. Chairman Horton, you've mentioned in years past that it was going to take a while for us to recover from the economic recession. Many of you recall that it was 2009 was the last time that we saw $92 million in revenue. So while we may have recovered in revenue to $92 million, as you're aware, we still have a number of frozen positions within the county that have not been reinstated, some of which are in the recommended budget for your consideration for reinstatement. But again, you're not at full staff to where you were in 2009. Obviously, the cost of doing business with any type of inflation that's occurred in any of our operating expenses has had to be absorbed. So we're a lean operation when it comes to providing services. So you'll see the breakdown from there of this $190 million that we're talking about today. The library represents $13.5 million, solid waste fund $9.5 million, parks almost $8.3 million, the community college $7.7 million, Charles Lee $1.5 million, and all other funds. As you know, you administer other funds. You're the administering agency for funds like the Workforce Investment Board, the Forrester Center, and so on. All other funds, $56 million worth. Those include some internal funds as well. So I know from talking to you that a number of you want to see the bird's eye view of how the budget recommendation is broken down across all of those funds that we just talked about, right? These are all of the funding sources that you have either administration, control, or direct funding authority over. So how do those shake out in the areas of concentration? Well, as you see from the slide, public safety, all funds included, represent about 30% of your total budget. That's almost $55 million of the total going towards public safety functions. That can be law enforcement, detention, EMS, 911, emergency management, those type of critical services that by statute you're responsible for. Okay. The next largest portion of this budget is concentrated towards public works. And in that particular area, you're looking at about 12% of your budget, or $22.4 million, is going towards some form of public works. That can be your roads and bridges, solid waste, those types of functions. And then again, in looking at percentages, you have the judicial function, which is just behind public works at about 14.8, 14.9 million or 8% of your budget. Again, by statute, you're mandated to provide for judicial services, and you should be. These are courts that are provided for our citizens, from magistrate straight through general sessions and family court. Again, a large percentage of your budget. A number of you have asked me, so I want to be sure that the public understands this, for the folks who are wanting to know, what does transfer and other mean in that pie chart? Because it doesn't ring to a particular area that would be easily understandable, like public safety or public works. So transfer and other things contains transfers for our CIP and debt, those things that Jim's going to be talking about here at our next slide. And then, Councilman Hall, I know that you're over livability committee, and you may know this, but other council members or members of the public may not, but the quality of life section of that particular pie chart, that 18%, includes things other than the normal traditional things we think of for quality of life. It also includes the library, the community colleges, and the community college, in addition to parks, Councilman Hall, in your committee, we spend a lot of time talking about parks and perhaps less about the library and community college, which are very integral parts of our quality of life here in Spartanburg County. So taking a look at the general fund operating budget, again, we mentioned it was just over $92 million. So what comprises those revenues? And I know that you have been particularly careful to ask questions about what is dependable and stable revenue versus one-time revenue that goes towards that $92 million, recognizing that as you make decisions today and in the future about recurring costs, that you want to be sure that you have the revenue to cover those costs. And that if the revenues aren't particularly predictable, that those types of revenues should go towards capital, one-time capital costs. So let's talk about how that revenue figure has been forecasted for you. So the largest portion of it, of course, is our tax base. And that's real estate, vehicles, business, personal property, any assessable transfers of interest, all those things that come from the property taxation side of the house for your revenues. It also includes permits and fees. As our Register of Deed, Dorothy Earle, could attest to, we're seeing a much higher volume of land transactions, which is good. We're seeing a large number of land transactions. As our Planning Director, Bob Parkrader, our Building Official, Jerry Glover, and as our Public Works Director, Travis Brown, could tell you, we are definitely seeing higher development activities. You are seeing it in your districts as well. So we are seeing additional revenues in that area as a result of that. Fines, so these are largely in the judicial system. Those are trending downward. We've talked with our chief magistrate, with our clerk of court, and others trying to make sure that we understand what those trends are so that we don't over-obligate to those revenues. And from clerk of court Hope Blackley to our chief magistrate David Turner to our solicitor Barry Burnett, they've been very helpful in providing this information since they have a bird's eye view of how those fines are working through the different court systems. As council has mentioned in earlier meetings, we're not aware of any increased local government fund. There is a bill working its way, I believe, through the Senate that would add additional funding to local government fund. At this point, any addition that may be contemplated by the General Assembly has not been included in your revenue figure. That would, if any of those bills or provisos work their way through the General Assembly, those would be additional revenue to the $92,752,000
we're projecting. Mr. Mayor.
Yes, sir.
If, and I think I saw what was 28 million that we're looking at in that addition. If that was to come about, do we go back and amend what we do today, or if we put it a second or third reading, would we, if it happens before then, what if it happens after?
So if it happens before your third reading, we can certainly have you amend the budget to have additional revenue, and you can choose how you want to allocate that revenue. Throughout the day today and throughout your future budget meetings, we'll be offering you some prioritized reinstatement spreadsheets of things that if we would have had additional funding, how we would have presented the recommended budget, as simply our guidance to you on where you may want to look for reinstatement. But your priorities as a group may be to put that as a one-time capital towards another use, perhaps. But in direct answer to your question, if it comes in sometime between here and third reading, we can work with you to help amend the budget. If it comes in after that, then we would use the budget amendment resolution tool that you have to recognize that additional revenue and then any allocations that you would prefer to make from that at that time.
Now, on the current amount, current statute, we're about, what, $5 million short this year?
Yes, just over $5 million short of the statutory allocation that the county should receive. And Mr. Chairman, as you have indicated in the past, we have not recognized any interest earnings in any of our revenue figures. They're dramatically down from where we were prior to the recession, but we're not counting any interest earnings in any of the revenue projections that are being presented to you today.
But are we not getting some interest somewhere? We just don't.
Yes, it's not very much in terms of the walker. It's stunningly less than where we were before. I've also had several of you ask me this question who've been on council for a number of years, because you track how much the value of a mill is in the general fund. It's just shy of $1 million. Mr. Chairman, I believe that you may have been wanting to ask me this question about where our assessed base is, just as a kind of keeping a global perspective. The assessed base has increased about 2.8% to just over $1 billion. That's noteworthy for a county in South Carolina to have that assessed base. By the way, when I talk about assessed base, that's not based on how much money we're going to get exclusively. We share with a lot of taxing entities, but just as a marker of growth and value, right? I know that several of you track that. So carrying us to what the gap was that we needed to close, the requested budgets totaled over $102 million for the general fund. And we're presenting a balanced budget with recommended expenditures at just over $92 million. So again, our gap has been about $10 million that we've had to cut from the budget request. This is certainly, as you indicated, Mr. Chairman, a team effort between us and the senior management team and elected officials. And I really am very proud of the teamwork that's approached that. We've had several departments that are under a lot of pressure right now because of growth, saying that they recognize that while they can take all of the new revenue and take care of priorities in their department, that they know that the other department heads are seeing that growth as well. So they're asking us to try to find the best balance to help all.
And Catherine, I'd like to stop you right here. And again, thank you, department heads. But one thing you can do to continue to help us, especially with this bill that's going through with elected official mails, contact your representative and tell them to fully fund the local government fund. This year, if the deficit is $5 million, that's about $24 million since 2009, that we have been slighted, that we are providing services for the state and using your tax dollars to fund those services. They've been surpassing, getting by that by doing a proviso in the budget. And if they, this year, would fully fund the statutory requirements of the local government fund, we'd have $5 million extra dollars in here that we could either lower taxes or provide additional services. So please contact these individuals in the legislature and tell them to fully fund this thing, because it has been a major, major burden on us and local taxpayers, because again, we're having to take your tax dollars and pay for rent on certain agencies that they're supposed to be provided. So please contact them. Let's get this thing back. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. You may recall last year we were in a very similar boat of having about $10 million to cut. And what I can offer, several of you have asked me the question about that. What I can offer to you from my own bird's eye view, from the time I've spent with department heads in talking about their budget, they have requested items that I would call necessities. These are not extravagant requests. They're not trying to do anything other than to provide the bare minimum services to our citizens. They recognize that if they don't ask us and don't talk to us, they don't ask us for additions to their budget where they see the need, or that they don't tell us what some of the challenges are that they're facing, we're not omnipotent. We're not clairvoyant. We need to know these things so that we can help share what those needs are with you. Our needs are growing, and they're growing at a faster pace than our revenue is. And that's the bottom line with why we still have a $10 million gap, even though we're seeing additional revenue.
And just to go back in history, and I'll recognize just a second, David, one more time. Back in the year 2000, if you remember, the legislature asked the state, the people of South Carolina, do you want to lower your automobile taxes? And it passed about 60-40. And basically it dropped the assessment ratio of an automobile from 10.5% down to 6%. Thank goodness they did that in 0.75% increments, I believe, and let us down gently. But during that decade, from 2000 to 2010, That cost the county a little over $30 million that we did not get to replace, that your fire department did not get to replace, school districts. And so that was $30 million that left. Now, I think we all agree we want lower automobile taxes. But what makes it unique is there's no taxing entity for the state on your property tax notice. It'll be, you know, your school district, your fire department, county government, library, da-da-da, on down the line. There's no state agency on there. So they had no skin in the game. It didn't cost them a dime to do that. So we lost that $30-plus million, and now we're at $24 million for this decade. So let's do what we can to get this rectified if possible.
Absolutely.
David?
Yes, I was just going to say, you're absolutely right, Jeff and Catherine. And it's not that we need this extra $5 million just to go out and spend for new things. It's just the department heads that are out here. You know, take a look at the Judge Caldwell, probate judge's office. Until you have a death in the family, which every one of us has, the impact that has on the families, that ripple effect goes throughout the county. And we can't help her service our citizens to the degree they deserve. And right on through, just like you say with all the other departments, that touch people's lives every day. People who want the property across from them cleaned up, or the county owns or work on from Jamie Nelson, animal control and litter control, the things that we can do to help improve the services, that's what we're talking about. And department heads, you make a phone call, a legislator gets 5 phone calls, and that's big news for him. And as Bob can attest to that, when he was in the House, you get 5 or 10 people calling about a problem, like the local government fund, they start listening. Because we hear it all the time. We heard it last year. Nobody ever calls us and tells us this, except maybe the 7 of us. So help, and like Jeff said, help us help the citizens of Spartanburg, if you would.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I'd like to walk through a number of highlights for you. Obviously, through this work session, we'll be happy to go through each department level, through functional area level details, but I think there's a couple of things that really resonate as highlights in this budget that may be helpful to go over this morning. So the first, I feel we understood the priorities of council. If we did not, please correct me as we go through this so that we can get realigned with what your priorities were. As I understood it, council was looking for a pay package to be included in the budget recommendation that was sustainable. So I'm recommending a 2.75% across the board increase for employees. Now that would be coupled with last year's 3.75% increase, would be a total of a 6.5% increase over 2 years for our employees. Would I like to recommend more than 2.75%? Yes, I would like to. I know that our employees deserve it. They're working hard. They're working with less support in their departments because we still have a number of frozen positions. But I share with you that as a senior management team and as your administrator, I recognize that any increase that you give needs to be sustainable. Not really sure. I don't think that you're really sure if we have pulled ourselves completely out of the economic recession we have been in. So this is a cautious but very deliberate and heartfelt recognition of the value of our employees that we need to continue to add to their salary. They have needs that they need to meet with their own families, and I recognize that. They went for a number of years without pay increases. I also recognize that. Ultimately, as the senior management team and I have discussed, and as council and I have discussed, I'd like to see us go to a merit pay package. This would be performance-based salary adjustments. My belief is, from my own practical experience in my former position in human resources in a previous county, that we need to have that merit pool at 4% before we begin to do merit pay. That would be my goal. So when we looked at if we're being conservative with our recurring costs, was there an opportunity beyond the salary adjustment across the board to try to get more support to the department? And I believe there is. There are a number of, a short number of frozen positions that are in the recommended budget to unfreeze, and I'd like to review those with you. We have two construction equipment operator positions in roads and bridges that are being unfrozen and included, as well as the assistant director position in the building codes department. This is a mid-year addition contingent upon the revenues remaining as strong as we're predicting. In the environmental enforcement department, a property maintenance inspector and an animal control officer to meet the increased need that we're seeing for customer service. In the communications department, adding additional funding for dispatchers, mostly in the fire area. This is under their temporary health provision that council's provided. All of these positions recommended, or all of these positions that are in the recommended budget, represent areas where we're seeing a high level of pressure. They're not exclusive, but in keeping with your instructions to me, your advice to me, to be very careful about unfreezing positions and to place priorities each year where we can try to help with customer service, this is where I think those needs need to be. That does not mean that the positions that are not being unfrozen are not needed. Just this is what we can afford right now, and I think it'll meet some significant needs within the organization.
Catherine, what the 275 increase, what does that represent in millions of dollars?
A little over $1.5 million.
Thank you.
So beyond that, as I understood council's guidance to me, is that if we could avoid unfreezing a position but reallocate duties to existing members of the team and they could handle those additional duties, not conceptually or skill-wise, but just the volume of the additional responsibilities, if we could reclassify and avoid unfreezing or delay unfreezing, that you were interested in what those recommendations would be. So let's walk through, there's a whole list of those reclassifications before you, but I want to provide particular note to a couple of them because I think you'll see the trend of where those reclassifications are occurring. So in the Register of Deeds office, unfreezing the Deputy Register of Deeds position, Dorothy needs some additional help with the volume that she has. What she's offered here is to then refreeze another position that she has in exchange for that. In the building codes department, we're looking at some reorganization that would have four senior code enforcement officers and a permit administrator working together to help Jerry and his team with the inspection process. We also have in the stormwater area, two reclassifications that help us with managing the grading permits that are coming into the department. That would be in the stormwater manager position and the engineering tech 2 position. We're also asking our recycling coordinator to take on some additional duties to help us in not only the stormwater area, but also in the solid waste area. So there would be an adjustment in a reclassification there as well. And then you'll see several of the agencies that you oversee funding for as an administering agency trying again to reorganize and distribute duties without adding additional positions. Those positions you'll see on your spreadsheet from the Public Defender's Office, Workforce Investment Board, also in our IT department, that's an internal fund, and then in our Parks Department, reclassifying the Assistant Parks and Recreation Director position to allow Kevin the opportunity to hire a deputy director. That position was frozen when Jim Campbell took over the interim position. So again, that's not an exhaustive list, but those are hitting the highest areas where we've looked at reclassifications. But you have a printout in front of you that shows all of those. If you take a look at, also at your desk, the list of unfunded personnel requests, you'll see that they total about $500,000 in requests. Again, those are prioritized so that if you see additional funding, like Councilman Walker pointed out, and you'd like to put any of that funding towards personnel, we've offered you some guidance in where we would start with that. So that's personnel. On the capital needs, I think, as I understand it, that you were asking us to look primarily at our public works, primarily roads and bridges, side of the house, trying to walk away from our reliance on master leasing, taking care of deferred capital. So let's talk about a couple of the highlights in the budget there. One of the things I heard at an earlier meeting that was incorporated into the budget was you wanted us to see some additional funding go to the Steve Ballou Fund, which you'll see in your presentation here shortly, that we're looking at increasing that fund on an annual basis over the five-year term of the CIP. As I recall from earlier conversations, that fund, and you may recall this as well, that fund was established intentionally to allow any carryover to accumulate in that fund. So while you may see an additional $25,000 allocated, keep in mind that this year you may see $75,000 to $100,000 worth of carryover added to the $275,000 that is being recommended for that, the increase of $25,000. So that would present to you a larger amount, and each year that will continue to accumulate. We also, and I don't want to take away from Jim's presentation, but he'll be telling you more about our strategies on how to reduce our reliance on master leasing. Again, that's a misnomer. We don't lease vehicles. We do loan payments on vehicles. And council's objective, which I share as well, is to do cash financing of vehicles. And we'll talk a little bit more about a long-term strategy to walk away from that. Each year we do a little bit more, so we have no more IT equipment on the master lease. We don't have any general fund vehicles, any ambulances, and we're going to start to take the remaining amount of vehicles that we have on that off in smaller pieces over the next couple of years and accelerate that at the point at which we can accelerate it if funds are available. Jim will also be going over particularly our resurfacing capital. He'll walk you through some of the additional funds that we'll be putting in this year and next year towards the ROD's office with regard to microfilming our mortgages and our indexes over a two-year period. The increased coverage for our VHF system by adding another tower and so on. I've had a chance to talk with you each about a list of capital items that need to be addressed. And I think I've shared this with you as well. Although it is properly called the capital improvement plan, right now it's trying to catch up on what we need to take care of plan. It'll turn into a capital improvement plan once we get caught up. Okay, before I move to the next slide, are there any questions about those highlights? Let's walk into how we tried to align the budget documents to your strategic vision. For anyone who isn't aware of, and I would imagine there are very few people left who aren't aware of the fact that council has gone through a very detailed strategic visioning process. You offered guidance to us on goals with specific objectives. The budget, as you recognized, was your funding mechanism for your strategic vision, right? It's where you put the money towards making your vision happen, those things that you have direct control over the financing. So, as you look at your budget book, for the first time, you'll see our attempt at pulling your strategic vision into the budget and actually showing you what particular expenditures are going to help you accomplish specific objectives. So just as a housekeeping orientation for you, each tab that you have in your budget book, if you'll go to the second page on any of those tabs, you'll see in those, each one of your functional areas, on the second page you'll see an overview with goals and objectives outlined for you. Your actual strategic vision itself is the second page of your budget book, prominently placed in the very front, really as your outward expression that your strategic plan guides all of your decisions. And we're going to come back to page 2 and 3 of this document here a little bit later. But let's just jump right in so I can summarize for you as you're reading through your budget a couple of things that I thought illustrated how you're accomplishing goals 1, 2, and 3 with specific examples under your objectives. This is not exhaustive, but just for the point of showing you how we attempted to do this and to get your feedback on whether this is helpful and what you're looking for, okay? So under goal number one, you're trying to make it clear in your strategic vision that you're creating sustainable economic development. I know you do that at every meeting, but what are we doing every day within the team to help you with that? So as you look through the budget, you should find for objective 1.1, you should see continued funding for Infomatum at the requested level. That's done through the COG. I know Councilman Hall, you've been involved as the chairman of the COG for, I believe, 2 years. How time flies.
Yes.
This project is very important to the Economic Futures Group and to Council in trying to help have statistics ready for economic development. There's continued funding within the budget for that. We've also been working with the community college on helping them with their goal of additional repairs and support for the Tiger River campus. I'm sure Councilman Britt can help with any questions that may be about the importance of the Tiger River campus when it comes to the Center for Business and Entrepreneurial Development helping with our economic recruitment initiatives. On objective 1.2, as Council's aware, we're moving forward with area performance planning. In the southwestern corridor area, in your budget, there's continued funding with staff for staff support and moving forward with the actual implementation of area performance planning. Mentioned again here as an emphasis in section or objective 1.3, the Center for Business and Entrepreneurial Development, the funding and support for that is also a shared responsibility with the community college with your support of their function. And then really the lion's share of the infrastructure discussion in goal number one really relates back to public works. So roads, bridges, stormwater, solid waste, vehicle, and equipment replacement, all of that's in here, as well as the establishment of the Steve Ballou Fund. So again, just trying to tie your objectives to the heart of the budget, right, with where you're actually placing an emphasis on your spending. Any questions when we move to goal number two? And just for feedback for me and for our team, we've been very anxious. Of all the things we've been nervous about today is presenting to you how we tied your strategic vision to your budget. For feedback to us, is this what you had hoped for, envisioned that we would start working towards? This is our first step. As we've discussed with several of you, if this is what you were looking for as we were tying it in, then the next step would be to start tying measurable outcomes to that as well during the budget process so that you can start to quantify how you're impacting your vision through the budget. So are we close? Are we on the right track?
I think so. About the only thing I know you need to do differently next year is make sure that myself, David, Justin get the right email on the proper jacket where I get the council.
You can fully fund the dress code.
That's right. Yes, I'd bring it up and light it up.
I think it's excellent. I went over to economic development. I think it's perfect the way you did 1.1, 1.2, because it does tie in. It helps bring everything that we're all doing into focus, you know, having a vision and having a mission and a plan to get it done. And it helps. I think it's absolutely, yeah, right on the spot.
Well, thank you. I have to admit that I can take no credit for what you're seeing other than asking for this to be done for council. It really was our budget management team and all of the senior staff that you see behind us. That was a priority going through this budget process, and I'm very proud of what they've accomplished in doing this.
And I say it a lot at council meetings, and you know, the team that's in here is not all of them always in the council meeting, but every department, every person in here affects our ability to recruit not just the BMWs and the Torres and the others, but every small company, because they want to know, you know, again, they're bringing key people, a few key people here, but they're investing millions and billions of dollars. is this a safe place? The sheriff's department, you know, are all the other departments working together to make, you know, Spartanburg a place that they want to put, again, their money and their people and their lives? Because a lot of these companies are looking here are not just looking at Spartanburg as a place to put a facility. A lot of them are planning on this becoming their home. So everything from Jerry Glover's group, you know, early on working to, you know, make that permitting process and getting it done. Again, see Jamie out there, making sure this, the county looks just like you want your home to look, as an inviting place, a nice place. All the stuff that Jane and Mayor Harris worked on for so many years and fought hard for, with the parks and the Blue Ways and you know, the new beginnings and having this revolutionary Spartanburg. All that stuff makes a difference. And again, tied in with what Alan Smith did at the Chamber with that video, that's what makes us the only and the one Spartanburg that we are. So everybody in here makes the success of Spartanburg key. And you know, and I do appreciate it. I mean, I live here, I work here, I invest here. This is where I want Spartanburg to be the best we can be, and we're doing that as a team. So every department in here makes a significant, you know, difference. Neil, what you're doing at the jail, the stuff that was just reported in the Herald Journal about, you know, educating the inmates there, giving them hope and opportunity. That's what we're all about. And it's a big, big difference. And this is the place to do business, not just to make stuff, but Spartanburg County is a county that does business right. We're known for that. I mean, sometimes I think we take it for granted just how good we are. And you know, Catherine and your team that's out there, you go to other counties, we talk to site selectors. It's not the same way, not just across South Carolina and the other 45 counties, but across the United States. A lot of people, they build roadblocks versus, you know, we build bridges. We make things happen fast. And so this is perfect. I love it.
Well, thank you. As you're going, I know that we've, Chairman Horton, you asked that I sit down with each council member ahead of time and walk through the budget, answer any questions to help prepare for today. I know that this budget book, we were making adjustments to the budget book as we met with you to make sure we were including information you're looking for. So today's really the first day you've had an opportunity to see it all pulled together. You've seen drafts and pieces of it, but today's really the first day. What I would ask is, and I know that you're all very busy, if you have a few moments, take a look at the formatting of the budget and let us know if we have addressed the desires that you've had to make this more informative for you and to help tie into your plan. Any suggestions that you have, we'd be glad to incorporate those as we move forward to expand time in your strategic vision into your budget as the funding mechanism for your plan. So I'm going to carry you to goal number two then. So this is capitalizing on natural resources and tourism opportunities. So largely within the livability community or committee at face value, but truly all of the other committees, as Councilman Britt just pointed out, really support the natural resource opportunities and tourism opportunities here, because if we're not an inviting community, if we're not a safe community, then our tourism opportunities will be limited. So while I will give a very specific shout out to Kevin Steens and his team for doing an amazing and remarkable job with our Parks Department, especially under his leadership with the business skills he brings to this and the excitement and background that he has, the stars are really the limit here, right, for where we want to go. And I believe that Kevin can take us there to accomplish what Council's vision is with goal number two. Let's talk about a couple of pieces of this, because clearly Kevin can't do it by himself. We have partners with our CBB, Chris Jennings. I doubt that I need to go very farther with calling out names like Chris Jennings and Alan Smith and the support that they provide to our team. But let's just take a look for a moment as we're talking about this budget, about what you put into place just in the last year, because I think sometimes we forget how much has happened on this particular goal. So Councilman Walker, Holston Creek is open. We have a very exciting disc golf tournament happening this weekend. It was on in the paper today. If you haven't had a chance to see that story, I encourage you to hear the feedback from the folks who have been excited about this tournament, who don't work for us, who are talking about what an amazing gem we have with the disc golf particular course just at Holston Creek. Very, very unique and inviting. And the number of folks who are coming to compete in this tournament already who are registered is a first year amazing win for Holston Creek. Many of you were involved in, well, all of you were involved in the Cleveland Park community build and then again with the ribbon cutting of that facility. What a wonderful way to touch on goal number two, to bring Cleveland Park and Berry Field and those projects to life. The fields at Battlemore Park, Chairman Horton, which is close to your home and very special to you. The Lake Cooley Outdoor Center recently came online. That's a lot in just 1 year to see come to fruition. So I offer to you that, again, with your strategic visioning, if you will let us know where it is you want to go and how quickly you want to get there, I think the proof is in the accomplishments. We've done those things. We've cut ribbons and opened up facilities. I'm not sure how many of you had the chance to go by Cleveland Park just to drive by it on the weekends. It's packed.
I drove by Saturday afternoon about 5:30, and I bet there were 1,000 people there.
How long?
885 children.
How wonderful.
It was unbelievable.
How wonderful. What an amazing asset you provided to this community to enjoy and to make memories. So I'm so happy to hear that you're seeing as well the interest our community has put in being a part of those open public spaces that they can enjoy. One of the other areas, so under goal number two, a couple of things that you'll see in your budget. Of course, we're continuing with our tourism promotion, the funding that you provide in outside agency allocation to the CDB with a slight increase from $200,000 to $225,000 from hospitality tax to help them enhance our tourism promotion, especially of our sports tourism. And then our continued financial support for the Tourism Action Plan and the Trail Master Plan. So just in the last year, again, to the point of things that we should take a moment to reflect on, you have the dedication of funding that you provided from the Trails Bank for Lawson's Fork, Cottonwood Trail, all this tie-in with the Glendale Bridge Project, and other trail segments, including the Wadsworth Trail and Drayton Trail, those segments that were brought online with your budget allocations. I've seen you at the different ribbon cuttings and at the groundbreakings for these trail extensions. There's an awful lot of excitement. I think even today I saw in the paper where the Cottonwood Trail has a new tourism promotion guide for that particular trail. You helped make that happen too.
Catherine, I'd just like to point out that, you know, it's great to have the parks and all that for our local residents to enjoy. But this is such an enhancement to what CPB is doing to actually bring conventions here to Spartanburg. And we have seen an increase in activity and interest in bringing conventions to Spartanburg. Once a person, you know, anybody who's ever gone away to a class, a course, or a convention somewhere, you have off time, and you want to know what you can do in that off time. And it's so wonderful to be able to say, well, we have these walking trails, we have the PALS and the bike program that is going on that is in combination with being able to work with our large municipalities, Spartanburg, and just having all of these things so that in that off time, these visitors to Spartanburg actually have places to go visit. The history in Spartanburg is phenomenal, in Spartanburg County is phenomenal, and to be able to bring that all in together for visitors that come here is truly a reason that they come back as well. So we're seeing an increase in that activity. That, to me, relates over to our economic development end of things. And I think it's a wonderful thing that we are doing in combination and in partnership with many other entities.
I was giving a talk Monday. Catherine was there.
to a chamber group, and there were a lot of people who weren't from Swarthmore in the room. So I gave a little history here. And I was thinking about Jeff, and I didn't mention your name, Jeff, when I was giving a talk. You know, to understand where we are today, you have to do a little reflection on where we were, not just 10 years ago, but even 25 years ago. We didn't even have a Parks and Rec department. When I got on council, when Jeff got elected, I think he was the first chairman of the Parks and Rec Committee. We used to contract with the city of Spartanburg to run our Parks and Rec department. Because again, thinking about where we were for 100 years, from the late 1880s to 1980s, the textile communities, they took care of all the Parks and Rec. Again, I think about Packlet, when we went down there, they had their own gyms, they had, you know, and all the other mills, they took care of everything. So, you know, the municipalities and then the county in 76 when we were established, we didn't have anything. And we have come light years, and Jeff was a champion for that early on. And we really have come light years in the last 5 to 10 years. And what we're doing and what we're offering, again, to the citizens of Spartanburg, but also these other people coming to visit. So Jeff, a ton of credit goes to you and Jane. And we're only starting to scratch the surface. I mean, we really are. This isn't, you know, just something that's nice to have. It's absolutely a necessity. Every time Kathy Dunleavy comes here, we talk about our, you know, the obesity problem and children and adults not being able to get out and walk. These paths that we're building that, John Montgomery talked about it, even over at Drayton Mills and the things that they're doing. I run on the rail trail probably 5 days a week. It's incredible how many people out there on a 1.8 mile little course. But I go to some of our neighboring states or locales. When I stay at one, I ask the hotel, what do they have that I can do? Austin, Texas, tremendous running trail around the lake. We've got the resources. We've got the blue ways. That's why I think we just start to tap into what we've got going on. And I looked at the number there. We have 300,000 people now live in this county. Again, when Jeff and I were first, on council, 216. That's amazing in a short amount of time, and more coming. So congratulations to you two and all. Also to you folks making it happen. But we have come a long way.
Any questions on goal number two before we move to goal number three? Let's take a look at goal number three. This has to do with the allocation of resources and focusing on quality service delivery. So all of our departments, although they support goal number one and goal number two, a lot of the rubber meets the road on goal number three, because we're really getting into the heart of how we make recommendations to you on how to spend the remaining funding. So as we mentioned earlier, we've been for objective 3.1, again, walking away from our master leases as a financing tool and continuing to focus on building the general fund balance. So one of the things that came out of your retreat last year was that you were looking to get us to a 20% unassigned fund balance as soon as it was practical. Obviously, these are all choices. You could take all of the new revenue and move it over to the unassigned fund balance and check the box. But that would not pay attention to deferred capital or to a salary package or to customer service needs that are growing. So trying to feather all of that is a challenge that you face, that I face. As we've been preparing for the year-end closeout, the current projection is that we'll be at 18.9% unassigned fund balance by June 30th. That's a significant step forward from 2011, where you were just over 10%, had gone below 10%. So a very dedicated commitment on your part and on your direction to us to try to build that unassigned fund balance. As you have pointed out, really since I've been here, you recognize that 20% represents what a sound, financially stable county of our size, really of any size, but let's just talk about our size, what we should have. in order to demonstrate that we can weather storms and plan for the use of unassigned fund balance for planned capital needs going forward. It's a smart financial policy and one that the rating agencies have been celebrating your direction towards. So 18.9% forecasted for June 30th, barring anything major. Put that number out there, that's usually just inviting something to happen. So I hope that our next few months are blessed here at the county and we reach the 18.9%. So we're well on our way to trying to meet that goal next year for you. We can say we reached it and you can decide how much farther you want to go or whether you want to redirect some of those funds we've been using to try to get there towards another priority. Okay?
Mr. Chairman, if I could just touch on what Catherine just mentioned. I completely support our goal. That is a good goal to get us to a point of being fiscally stable to ensure that we have the funding for when those needs are there. So I completely support us continuing to go down that route and want us to keep doing that, because I think it sends a message to everyone that we are reminding our priorities. At the end of the day, priorities don't just matter when we have a downturn and we're having to watch our pennies. It's also important when we're seeing increases and we have to prioritize that spending. So I absolutely want us to continue on that path. As we move beyond this budget, and we move beyond what we're talking about today, and go into the strategic visioning process that I think is going to talk about our priorities and talk about as we look forward long term. One of the things I would like us to look at, and I would just ask my fellow council members and staff to consider as we get into that strategic visioning process later this year, to look at how we adjust those priorities once we get to that 20%. For me, I think a couple of priorities are important things we should look at. Road funding, making sure we're ensuring that we're directing the resources necessary to maintain our roads and really make sure that core government need is addressed. And then also trying to accelerate paying off our debt, both short-term and long-term, continue to get away from the master lease, looking at our long-term bonds, and continue to accelerate that process just to build our financial stability. So that would just be my request to staff and council, just to continue to move in that direction, because I think that just keeps putting us on the right path going forward.
Those are all good objectives.
Mr. Chairman, Councilman Bradley makes a very good point. As we go through this budget process, if you will let the staff know those things that you want to focus on, as you did last year, you asked us to bring to you focusing on our financial policies and on roads and bridges, where we were going. That's what you wanted to have a lion's share of your time at your retreat last fall, which I hope has helped you prepare for today. As you look forward to this year's retreat, if you'll let us know through this process and as we're getting our agenda together for your review, if there's something that you want to focus on, like a retooling or refocus on our financial policy post 20% for the unassigned fund balance or roads and bridges, dedication of financial resources, those types of things, like you mentioned, Councilman Bradley, are very helpful for us to know in advance of your retreat with as much lead time as possible so that we can get the data for you that will be helpful in your decision making. So please, I encourage you to all share your thoughts, either collectively, individually, privately here, whatever comes to your mind as a priority. If you'll help us with that, we'll make sure that your retreat is beneficial for you as you talk about these short and long term goals. So moving on to objective 3.2, there are a number in your budget document as you're reviewing it. You will see that there are a number of very wonderful examples of how our team is looking to maximize the resources that you're providing. As I use examples, I recognize that I take a chance of leaving someone out who really wanted to see their department in the presentation. I'd be glad if you ever asked for an exhaustive list during the budget process. I'd be happy to do that. As you know from your retreat, on actually objective 3.2, we gave you a handout of every department's top priority in that area. But I wanted to call attention to one particular project in this area, or one emphasis that I think is really helping to demonstrate what we're looking for, what I think council's looking for in this particular goal, and that's the clerk of court's office, very continued advancement of technology. In this particular area, I know that clerk of court Hope Blackley has been involved in technology before I came here. She was very instrumental in the CAT team discussions about moving the needle forward with technology. Particularly her scanning of documents so that they're available electronically and using pay cards or debit cards. I'm still learning the lingo for child support and exploring e-filing. These are all things, as I have understood from council, how you want to push things forward when it comes to technology, so that you can, if you can, grow without adding staff by using technology. If you can get services to more people more efficiently, more timely, e-filing, does that increase office efficiency? But you can get your payment online, or you can work through online service, access points for payment of, for example, child support. So I think, although if you ask me to right now, I would turn around and go row by row to each department and tell you each one of them is making strides in this area. I wanted to give a special recognition of what the clerk of court's office has done in trying to meet goal or objective 3.2. Moving on to 3.3, the methane extraction program. So some of you would not have been here when the county started to its partnership with a methane extraction project at the Welford landfill, but for, and I know that you've asked questions about that, we've tried to bring that to you, but for those who have really been watching this story every year, the county share of the revenue will switch from 25% to 75% probably in the next year. A lot of it depends on a number of things that are out of your control, but what a wonderful story this has been for us in our partnership to capture something that was just being released into the atmosphere and turning it into a revenue source. So, wonderful project. We have an opportunity to showcase that to other communities who are looking to do the very same project, and how proud we are to do that. And it's not on the screen, but you'll recall in goal 3.5, you asked that we recognize high-performing staff members at council meetings. That's not actually in your budget, but it's a recognition that each meeting I share with you staff members who are going the extra mile to provide customer service. In some cases, it doesn't cost you anything in addition to provide the right attitude, the right building bridges, as council member Britt pointed out. They're doing that because they work for Spartanburg County and they're proud of it. And it's certainly my pleasure to recognize them at your council meetings, and I thank you for giving me that opportunity. Any questions on goal 3 as it ties into your budget? All right, I'm going to take you to goal number 4. And instead of listing all of these, how it's tied into your budget, I'm going to ask you to turn to page C2. It's behind the very first tab. So this will be the second page of your budget. I mentioned it to you earlier as just an opportunity to show you the emphasis that we try to place on your vision, mission, and values, your goals and objectives. They're printed on the second and third page. If you take a look at goal number 4, you'll see that you're doing all of those things collectively with administration to try to accomplish goal 4. For anyone who doesn't happen to have goal 4 in front of you in the audience, goal 4 has to do with council's very stated commitment to the implementation of the strategic plan and the realization of the vision being inclusive for this community. So you'll see you have a series of objectives underneath there that have to do with developing operational plans, measuring resources, and the outcomes of those, how we allocate resources, convening an annual retreat, utilizing the vision, mission, and values to brand our message as we work forward, and then using it as a guide to your decision making. You're doing all of these things. I could put up on the slide examples from your meetings. You know these examples already. But just know that simply by not pointing this out in the budget, you're really, as particular line items, you're setting the direction, and I hope that that's helped you have a better budget product as we go forward. Any questions about the alignment with the goals and objectives? All right, before we talk about budget reinstatement priorities, I just wanted to touch on a few things that may be obvious, may not be obvious from prior discussions. In the budget, there is no increase in the health insurance premiums for employers. As far as we've been told, there is no increase in employee premiums either, meaning that there was a slight adjustment at the state for increasing premiums that they charge us for dental insurance, that we've been able to absorb those within our existing established premium that we set for each position. On the retirement contribution side, going into the budget, we were told there would be no adjustment to the employer or employee side of this calculation. I'm sure that you've read the same stories that I have. The General Assembly has been talking about the shortfall at the Public Employee Benefits Authority level. We haven't heard what the implications may be this year. Of course, you're no stranger to this. If there's an adjustment either up or down in what the budget needs to be, we'll need to make those adjustments as we go through the budget process if something moves forward. Ultimately, there is a shortfall in the state retirement system that is outside of your control. We participate, it's not an optional participation, so we're at the mercy of how that problem is solved. It will eventually have to be solved. So I encourage all of us to pay close attention to how that discussion moves forward. There'll be practical implications for us as an employer if the rates go up, contribution rates go up, and for our employees if their contribution is also increased. Also in your budget, as you move forward, there have been only a few minor changes to fees. I would call your attention as we're talking about this to some minor changes to the park fees, but there's no change in the development fees for building permits or grading permits or subdivision permits. We recognize that all of our commercial developments are trying to accelerate now with the economy turning around, as well as residential. When you ask me to take a look at that each year, I'm not comfortable making a change at this point, and we'll continue to evaluate those on an annual basis. So I think that what Jim has helped you with here is a packet of information that helps you with what is not in the budget. So if you add them all up, obviously you'll get to $10 million. In the case of the particular positions, we talked about $500,000 worth of positions that are included. We've offered those to you in a suggested priority order of reinstatement, if that's something that you want to consider.
Mr. Chairman, can I make sure that I'm correct? The unfunded liability for the retirement system, if there is talk about making changes, so we don't really have any say-so. Now, here again, as Chairman Horton expressed, we talk about the local government fund. Here again, this is everybody involved, all our employees. If they raise the employee share, then it probably would be an increase on county share, and I've heard figures as much as 11% that they would go to. It's very important for everybody in this room. Here again, being in that position, as Mr. Britt shared earlier, the delegation needs to be contacted. They need to know. Granted, there's something probably going to have to be done about this large unfunded liability, but you know, it's an interest that all of us in
sure. Very sensitive from the employer side, because anytime that you have an increase in your contribution as an employer to the retirement system, that means that revenue that you would otherwise put to services in the county, you'll have to redirect towards retirement. You've seen numbers like 200,000 in the past of your revenues that were going towards the employer contribution. and then obviously very sensitive to the employee impact. That means that if you give a raise of 2.75% and retirement contributions go up, then effectively the amount of take-home pay that you try to get to your employee team is reduced because their contribution goes up. So very important that we continue to watch this, not only for what the financial impact may be to us on the budget side, but from the long-term viability of the retirement system, which we're all very concerned about if we're relying on the system as employees. Understanding the long-term financial implications of their unfunded liability is important for all of us to watch, just as participants in the retirement system. So, Mr. Chairman, I think that is the general overview of the $92 million portion of the budget. Unless you have any questions or comments, I'd like to give you the opportunity to ask any additional questions before you address, hopefully, first reading of the budget today. That would give us the opportunity to have this scheduled for second reading and public hearing at your May meeting and third reading at your June meeting. I'd be glad to answer any additional questions.
I'll just have a motion on the first reading.
A motion, so moved.
Second. Now, any other discussion?
I'd like to say in 25 years of seeing budget presentations, without a doubt, this is the best I've ever seen.
Thank you.
And the booklet, everything that y'all have done to put this together is remarkable.
Thank you. I'd like to set aside and Cole Alderson and Kelly Newman with the help of the departments, obviously.
Stay below Roger. Look, I'm going to let him have mine. Justin.
You didn't get a jacket.
I guess you've got some more on that.
Yes, we have a combination of
CDs.
Oh, they're on your CDs. Oh,
they're
not that.
They're young people. They know how to work hard.
Yeah. Yeah. Save money where we can, Roger.
I do want to make a couple of comments. Catherine, as we discussed, I'm really impressed with the team's ability to look at the vision and to come up with some priorities. When Catherine presented me with an overview of the budget, the first thing that I saw, I'm sure everybody's committee saw things that they liked about the budget, but I recognize that the council's vision was to ensure that we put prioritization on our infrastructure and our technology. That's two of the things that I saw in the budget that were really a priority, and I really appreciate that. It's easy to do the things that people see outwardly, and a lot of times we things that are underground don't necessarily get a lot of attention, but they get a lot of attention when they start breaking down, and the public realizes that, and that's another thing the public can see. But not always, and it's not always a pretty thing to fund, but I really do appreciate the priority that was put on our infrastructure and moving forward in the direction that we're going. I have one thing that I think I brought this up before, and it's just something that I noticed at the end of every month when we're paying the taxes, and I haven't brought this up to you, and I apologize, I don't mean to spring anything, so whenever you get around to kind of looking at it. We have a convenience fee, I guess, that's charged for people who use credit cards. And I think we can do some type of study or something to look at the break-even point between what is the point where it will drastically reduce the people that are here trying to pay their taxes at the end of the month? And I know we could say everybody will come in as soon as they get their notice and not wait 3 months later to pay at the end of the month. And that would be ideal, obviously. But people show up at the end of the month, they wait in line for an hour or so, maybe sometimes, and gets all the way back here. There's got to be a break-even point where we can say, you know, whatever they're charging us, if there's a way we can look at some type of subsidy where, you know, if people will pay $10, but they won't pay $15. Just try to figure out where that breaking point is so that we can reduce this, because a lot of the companies that I see across the county are now going to them. Their goal is really to get people to do electronic payment. And it just eliminates the hassle for so much of our staff time. I think that would be something at least worth looking into and just seeing where is that breaking point where we can spend as little of the money as possible but still get the people the service that they need and just a thought.
And if I may, Councilman Nett, I don't know if Lindsey Brady is here or any of the folks from the specifically from the treasurer's office, but I'm not calling them out to ask them to come to the podium, but I do want to acknowledge their very determined efforts to try to work on the line that is obviously very present here at the end of the month and then at the end of the year, probably at a higher level. So they've done a number of things that I would want them to share with you in more detail as we present this information back to you, but I know that they upgraded their online payment options to where you could pay multiple bills at the same time. And that was a software upgrade that was important. If you have a fleet of vehicles that you are a business and you're paying for, and you have to go on, we all do shopping, I'm assuming online. So if you have to go for each item that you pay for, if you have to do a single transaction for that, that's very cumbersome and inefficient. And the treasurer's office recognized that and did a software upgrade last year that allowed you to combine multiple tax notices into one payment action online. What they had found was that there were a number of folks who had multiple tax notices who were waiting in line because it was actually more efficient to pull it up at the window here and have the clerk total it for you and then write one check than to sit at your own business and check out one at a time. So with the fear of missing a tax notice or something, I can understand the practical concerns of trying to single item those transactions. So they have made a significant stride there to try to help with customer service. And I think the treasurer's goal is that he keeps track of the wait in the line by asking folks how long you've been waiting in line, opens up all the windows with the goal of trying to keep folks in line less than 20 to 30 minutes. I've seen him put folks out who are doing non-cash payments actually in the hallway to try to pull people out of line who are doing, and I share all that with you, because I think he shares your concerns about the length of the line and looking ways to cut that down. And I'll follow up with him and ask him to share with us what those online fees are and what the impact would be of changing our approach to that. Both from a practical point for the length of the line and also from a financial point. Obviously, the fees have to be paid eventually. It's just a matter of who pays them, really, the county or the citizen. So I'll bring that information to you, and if it's something that you feel you could add to the agenda for further discussion.
Yeah, and I think it's important to get the word out about the upgrades we made. If they go on the property tax notice or, big letters, there's going to be X, maybe people think that in the past it's been whatever, and they haven't gone to look in 20 years, and maybe it's half of what it used to be. If we could have something on the tax notice that will let people know this is a really easy way to pay your taxes.
Sure. We've also reached out through our website. We have the county spotlight, and the treasurer's office put an article on that spotlight in November, December, when we first went live. It was one of our first stories that shared how you can avoid the line. And they offered some tips on how to avoid the line that would help make it more user-friendly. And perhaps we can take advantage of that and move it into other mediums other than just our website.
Okay, thank you.
Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, both affirmative, it passes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Next item is receive information, take desired action in reference to a budget ordinance to establish council project budgets for 2016-17 budget of the five-year capital improvement plan. Mr. Hill,
Kelly's going to drive. I want to talk. Mr. Chairman, good morning. Chairman, members of council, it's a privilege to represent this team in presenting their capital improvements, proposed capital improvements plan for the current fiscal year that you're looking at and the five-year program. About this time last, we were in a high pressure cooker conversation with Standard & Poor's actions you took earlier in the meeting relative to that, asking them to look at rating our credit worthiness. Part of that conversation really highlighted for me the importance of what we have been doing here with the capital improvements plan. Travis and I were really grilled about what our future plans for our landfill actually are and how we got there and why. And we could answer every question that those experts had of us because of the guidance that you provided us through this capital improvement plan. Now, there are many other reasons for us to consider and discuss and adopt a capital improvements program. But that really came home to me that morning a week ago. And I hope you will see the benefit of it when they release that rating in the morning.
Third day in the morning?
Yes, sir. That's what we understand. So the capital improvements program in your book starts on the third green tab in the back. It is, does indeed. Does indeed include the same attention to the mission, the vision, and the goals that Catherine has been discussing as we look out with our annual operating budget. And I will call your attention to the way it's put together, the summary information that begins on page 9 and runs through page 22. Is for me extremely valuable and gets you to the bottom line, but allows you to look at it in a number of different fashions, whether you're interested in a project look or a source of funding look or what may be your interest or the questions that you get about how we do our budget. So for us, CIP starts in October. So one of the things that we initiated now 3 years ago is an internal review component that is made up of a committee of subject matter experts from each of the functional areas that we cover. So a really good group of talented folks that have not only just the view and the information of what impacts their area, but they have a broader overview of what the demands countywide are and what may be some resources for us, such as in that committee or our grants people that understand where we can get revenue in addition to what is a property tax. So this plan, just like the annual operating budget, is brought to you with a great deal of consideration and input from a number of talented folks, and it's just my privilege really to speak for them. So as you look at the focus areas for our CIP, again, you will be able to tell very clearly that we're talking about infrastructure. We're emphasizing infrastructure. In the FY16-17 part of the CIP, 43% of the funding is allocated to roads and infrastructure. Overall, for the five-year period, 46% of the proposed funding is allocated to road infrastructure. And in doing that, we are recognizing and continuing the general fund support for the paving and infrastructure. In other words, we're not just relying on seed funds. We're not just relying on road fee. We're recognizing the demand, your expectation, and continuing to use a portion of the general fund there. So what does that percentage mean? That's $36 million over the five-year period that we're suggesting that we pledge to improvements to our roads. Also, along those lines, we're also funding roads and bridges equipment purchases. Again, pay as you go, So no longer capital lease or debt finance, at a level of $450,000 annually in this recommendation. So going down then, we again have our solid waste program, again, infrastructure. You know of phase seven. Phase seven is well underway at our Wilford landfill. We actually have our permits from the Army Corps of Engineers for our mitigation program. So there, that will allow us to maximize the use of the 420 acre property that we own in Wilford, where we currently operate our landfill, and make phase seven be a larger impact for the community as we go forward. We have cash funded, as I mentioned, both the roads and bridges and also our general fund vehicles. So as you look at this plan, the only debt service financing that we have in this is the replacement of the fleet necessary for the Sheriff's Department. And as we go through that, we'll work with you and the sheriff and his team to find ways to get ourselves out of that financing as well. We do have some investment in public safety infrastructure that I will speak of in more detail in a minute, and also the continued implementation of our parks enhancements fund. So as you look at with the annual operating budget, this slide shows you how the $16.5 million that we are requesting in capital expenditures for FY16-17 is broken down. Again, $7.1 million for road infrastructure, $3.8 million for vehicles, $1.6 million for public safety, $1 million for technology, $745,000 in solid waste, and $725,000 in parks. And we'll talk about that. So the highlights there are with our facilities, we're continuing to try to maintain this building. So we're doing some emergency chiller connections. That actually serves two purposes for us. It will set us up for the two-phase project that is replacement of our current chillers. And then if we do have any downtime, it will allow us to immediately connect a rental unit to get back up. We are proposing in this and funding in this budget a change in the way we attack, if you will, when we have ice and snow on our roads. We have been evaluating the brine system now for a couple of years. This is requesting funding for the liquid brine instead of the solid salt that we have been using. I think you will know if you've been around cities, actually SCDOT, applying the prime out in front of the storms. We have been evaluating that, and if we can produce our own, save money and provide a better service, if you will, for our roads. In our asphalt resurfacing program, we're looking at $3.9 million in total. That's $2.1 million from road fleet, $1.6 million from seed funds, and again, $200,000 from the general fund. But you also should note that our preservation fund is now at $900,000 if you approve this proposal. Our bridge and culvert program is at $450,000, and as Catherine mentioned, we do propose increasing the steep relief fund by $25,000, bringing it to $275,000 in the current year. And the five-year plan increases at $25,000 each year. In solid waste, in addition to our wetlands mitigation and our phase seven construction plan, We have container upgrades in our convenience centers, some resurfacing in our convenience centers, and the continued improvement to our methane collection system so that we can maximize those additional revenues that are coming there. In public safety, we are going to request to replace our call processing equipment, referred to in the industry as the CPE. CPE is the front end of the 911 operation. That's where we receive the calls. It will allow us, among other things, to be more efficient in receipt of calls, but also, if you recall our discussion with the state and Charleston County on our EZNet program, we have to have this upgrade in order to participate in the EZNet. In our economic and community development area, you approved the annual program that was presented by that advisory committee. I would say to you that is really strategic use of the funds that come from the federal government. The housing rehab program and our affordable housing program is at $533,000. And our community infrastructure, also to meet your goal of the infrastructure funds or improvements, is at $545,000 under that program. And if I will, you allow me to go back one step, back to 911. The other part in this recommended is a two-step program to add a tower. Catherine mentioned this as part of her presentation. Firefighters in the room will tell you this is needed. We had an engineering study to verify both the need and where we have the most bang for our buck as far as location. So our funding here would be to do a detailed engineering analysis in the northeast part of the county, Cooley Springs area, and evaluate the purchase of property, the site improvements, and start moving our infrastructure on site once we gain the property.
And how large is your property?
Well, that'll be part of the evaluation, but we have to put the building and all the equipment in the building on site. It can't be off site, so that the property is not just the tower. So the next phase of that would be the actual construction of the tower. Now, our initial thought on this and what brought this to priority in this plan was improvements to our VHF system and services, our fire departments, for firefighter safety. And as we've been looking at it, we've been working with the state PAL 800 folks. Some of you know George Crouch, who heads that up at the state level. We had George up here a couple weeks ago. He's coming back. Mike and I have had a couple follow-up conversations with him, and they have interest in that if we can increase the height of this proposed tower, that they may have interest in participating with us as well. We'll keep you updated.
I have a question. Why
would
you want to increase the height?
Increase the height.
Increase.
Yes. So for the VHF, we're talking about a 200-foot tower. If we look at partnership with the state, it's probably a 300-foot tower.
And Mr. Chairman, if I could also mention to Jim as part of this, we've been dividing the conference a lot this week. We haven't had a chance to talk about it. From yesterday, but Councilman Hall mentioned to me that as we look at that evaluation, Jim, she would like to see whether any of the progress on this VHF tower could help with the Connects Spartanburg project for Wi-Fi. Thank you.
Any other questions?
So then to technology. we have a number of improvements requested here. In the 911 area, it's a replacement of servers and computers. With our county network, it's our server replacement and our desktop replacement program, as well as our document management system. For us, we're very excited about being able to fund a large software improvement program that will upgrade our financial software package and allow us to do a number of different things that we cannot do today with our current software package. And we continue to roll out our voice over IP telephone system that is showing to be highly successful. Along with vehicle replacements, we do have replacements at our fleet services shop that we need to make those equipment replacements. And again, they're fully funded without any debt being issued. In our parks area, we do have our trails commitment that we've made. So the bicycle and pedestrian infrastructure item there is specifically related to our trail system. In our community parks, if you will go back with me to September, October, you will recall that we looked at the community parks program in detail, and actually in October, you adopted a budget amendment resolution that put us on this path, kind of modified where we are. So this is $550,000 specifically Mabry Park and Inman, Chesson Park, and the interim park improvements are part of this program as we outlined for you in October. And just have funded it here. So that's the $16 million for current year. Then if you look over the 5-year period, we're talking about almost $80 million of suggested capital improvement. Once again, the road infrastructure is the largest component of that, $36.5 million of that $79 million. Our vehicles replacement over that period would be $15.2 million. Our public service public safety upgrades would be $6.2 million in solid waste, and that's where we fully fund the phase 7 improvements, open a new cell landfill, again, without debt service. We plan that to be done paying. Our $3.3 million in our facilities, $3.1 million in technology, and $2.6 million in parks improvements over the 5-year period. So one of the highlights I need to go over with you is the building and facilities improvements. In FY18, this plan projects a small general fund, general obligation bond issue at $2.2 million. So we are paying off some bonds, and by virtue of paying off those bonds and reducing our debt service requirements, we're looking at funding some needed improvements. The boiler here, administration building, and some security upgrades, some renovations to Annex 2, some repavings both at the EMS headquarters and at our dent building, some much-needed improvements that we worked with Bill on out at the detention facility on California Avenue, and re-roofing of the entire headquarters at the Sheriff's Office. So those projects we propose to lump together in FY18 and issue that small general obligation bond to do so. We have had, due to some changes in the seed funds, we've had to elongate our schedule for bridge replacements, and that's anticipated over the 5-year period. In our public safety area, we do anticipate the full implementation of the 25 digital 800 megahertz system as part of mostly law enforcement, but also the EMS communications. That is roughly $290,000 per year starting in FY18. Our emergency management folks are replacing cardiac monitors. They will spread that replacement across 2 years. And again, with technology, we continue to improve there with our infrastructure, our document management system, and making available to folks online information that we have so that they don't necessarily have to come to this office to get that information. And that is across the board, but really is concentrated with some information at the registered news office. So that's where we're looking. It does extend the bulk of the funds under Objective 1.5 to develop an efficient and effective infrastructure plan. I believe this five-year program does that. And again, I would have to highlight that the work that's gone into it is much more than I sit here. It is really some good work, and I think both the press and encouraged by the look forward, the vision that we have based on the leadership is just counting. As with the annual operating budget, there's also, beginning on page 103, a list of those things we can't fund. And those items that were evaluated by the committee that weren't established as part of the funding at the current level.
Kelly, I understood every word you said.
All right,
Chairman, that's plan, Jim. A lot of work went into that, I know. And appreciate the presentation. Do I have a motion to give for free?
So moved.
And a second. Any other discussion now on the capital improvement plan?
Mr. Chairman, if I could just put an exclamation point on the points that everybody made earlier about the local government fund. That's money, county tax dollars that we're having to put towards the state bills, the state mandates, the state functions. That's money that we could put towards some of these capital needs. That's money, things that we're having to delay, whether it's bridge replacements, other items that we're kicking out longer because we don't have the money this year to be able to do it. If we had those monies from the local government fund that we could put towards those state needs, we would then have those county tax dollars free to be able to put towards these. And to quote the modern poet, Mr. Jay-Z, it's funny what 7 days can change. It seemed at the beginning of the year like we had some progress here. The governor, for the first time, had put full funding in her budget. Multiple legislative delegations have passed resolutions saying they support full funding. We have a lot of progress that's been made here recently on the local government fund. And yet, we still find ourselves short on this. So it's very frustrating that we continue to have to deal with that. So I, again, would just ask everybody to keep putting pressure on our representatives and our senators to support full funding. We have a number of members in our delegation that have fought for this. We appreciate their support, and we just ask everyone to continue to let them know that we need this full funding. If this was an issue where it was just two levels of government fighting over who can spend your tax dollar best, in principle, I would say we could do it better on the local level. But I would really, at the end of the day, say, what does it matter? But this isn't just two levels of government fighting over your tax dollars. This is mandates and bills that they have passed to us that we have to have this funding for. Otherwise, we continue to have to take our funding for our county needs and put it somewhere else. So I would just put an exclamation point on the points that have already been made for the local.
Very well said, Justin. Any other discussion? All in favor, raise your right hand. All opposed, I vote affirmative and pass. Mr. Hill, anything else? Ms. Kaplan?
No, sir.
All right, again, I want to thank each person being here today. And again, Kaplan and I, we have discussions, and she vigorously defends you when it's warranted, and she appreciates your input. And I like the fact that you're meeting with her, and then we have our retreat in the fall, and you're there as well. It really is helpful and beneficial. So overall, I think we got a great team going here in Spartanburg County, and let's continue to move forward. Thank you very much. We need a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor? Yeah. Thank you. Thank you.
Gotcha. Why not?